Good afternoon. At the beginning, there is nothingness. A few seconds pass with just a plain black screen. Speaking philosophically, a female voice breaks the stillness. It announces the lines that encapsulate the most fundamental views underlying the perspective of the Irish artist Duncan Campbell's 54-minute essay film, It for Others.
Objects exist outside of us. It is the confrontation of mind with matter that brings an object into being. Through their use, they provide subsistence, satisfy other human wants, and become the means and processes to produce more objects. The wealth of our societies exists as a vast accumulation.
Divided into four segments, It for Others features an array of artifacts from West Africa, a dance performance by Michael Clark Company, images of household objects, and archival footage from Northern Ireland. The work references other artists and filmmakers, including Chris Marker, Alain René, Stephen Shore, and Sergei Eisenstein, each in different ways invested in a critique of capitalism. All the images you will see, unless noted, are from the film. Despite initially starting as a post-colonialist criticism of British museums, as you can see through the text within the frame, the film is impressively richer. The work is a model of self-expression that tackles the problem of display, which is the question, how could museums not impose their will and thereby enact cultural imperialism on objects they collect and display? It for Others exemplifies a possible answer in its being that demonstrates signs of colonial subjecthood. Campbell stages in the film his views on the problem of display by yielding it as a subject that resists being defined by others. Campbell's film self-referentially deals with its own making and itself as a museum displaying objects. Since a display of objects which come into being elsewhere is representing something that exists in a context in another context, a display is recontextualization. As such, museums perform recontextualization that leads to impoverishing and imperializing cultures. It for Others acts like an ideal museum that actively tries to overcome such problems. The opening of the film historicizes its discussion in contextualizing its objects by pointing at a particular object. The female voice speaks again. This is a film about objects. It refers to another film about objects, specific African objects. A ballad of their mortality and death, Le Statue Meronossi. It for Others refers to Le Statue Meronossi, statues also die, as its model object. In situating its discussion around statues also die's contemporary context, the work starts a moment from the past. As the film progresses, it shifts to present. Marker and René's 1953 essay film, Statues Also Die, offers insight into damaging cultural impact of colonization, on how African art is perceived and removed from its original source and objectified. Statues Also Die depicts the Western museums as colonial structures that impose their will on the objects they display. It for Others begins with moments that are reenactments and recreations of Statues Also Die. In the first part of the film, Campbell creates a sophisticated reflexive meditation on appropriation of African artifacts. Through the discussion within Statues Also Die, we see how certain contexts necessitate the emergence of colonial subjects, displayed through the post-colonial context West Africa and the emergent negritude movement. Along the way, we are promised that It for Others manages a way out of the problem of display and how it does so. The voiceover reads, "Nothing prevents us from being the inheritors of two pasts if they meet with equality in the present." The film ends with this promise. We are told that it is possible only through an untraditional and complex manner, vaguely stated as meeting in the present. It promises, like a subject, that it would handle the problem by meeting with the viewer in the present. In what seems to be a reference to Jean-Paul Sartre, the title of the film refers to itself. It states of itself that it for others is a thing whose being is for others. Its value is for others to determine. However, just as the rest of the film, the title generates paradox as soon as we realize that through its working, it declares and forces its own being, thereby contradicting what its name declares. In Being and Nothingness, Sartre discusses notions such as being for others, being for itself, and being in itself. In a simplified manner, a being in itself is a being whose value is closed within itself. A being for others is a being whose value is defined by others, hence its being is for others to determine. Lastly, a being for itself is a being who resists being defined by others and exists to self-define its own being. In a sense, Sartre's being for itself is more or less synonymous with my use of subject. At one point, the film declares that a subject is, materially, a complex series of conditioned reflexes with a demonstration of the mechanism of associative thinking. Campbell materializes to his views on the problem of display by yielding it for others as a being for itself, namely a subject, that resists being defined by others, because given the philosophical obstacles and the historical context, this is the only possible way in which an artist can resist. In Michael Clark's segment, dancers illustrate Karl Marx's equations and diagrams that represent his labor theory of value. The film turns its focus onto the historical preconditions that lead up to the conditions that breed colonial subjects. In tracing the problem towards its presumed root, Campbell wishes to show that cultural imperialism is rooted in economic factors. Behind the objects that we contact through their aesthetic features, there lays their history, politics, and economic interests. The Clark section reveals the historical materialist mind behind the discussion at hand. Shifting the concentration further towards Marx's ideas, It for Others moves to its third chapter, The General Object. This chapter utilizes images from Stephen Shore's photographs and animations from TV advertisements to depict the history of the world of commodities. Campbell demonstrates how our everyday lives are filled with encounters with aesthetic objects as commodities and urges us to look beyond their aesthetic features. In a plain and simple setting, we see a hand putting a can reading Campbell's Condensed Tomato Soup as the title of the part, The General Object, appear in a large white font. Campbell's condense is a self-reference to It for Others itself as condensing Campbell in its being. Just as Campbell makes use of repetitive images at the aesthetic level to signal more abstract notions, so does he use other still images at the aesthetic level to signal abstract ideas. As the voiceover speaks along the scene, the maximum abstractness of an expanding idea appears particularly bold when presented as an offshoot from extreme concreteness, the banality of the stuff of everyday life. It for Others, an object, is Campbell, a subject, condensed. It is indeed bold. Campbell reveals the most general structure guiding his creation, the method of dialectics. The voiceover reads, "It's still very complicated to think in extra-thematic imagery, however, to show the method of dialectics. Through the creation of montages between seemingly incoherent parts, Campbell opens a space for the viewer to explore further by association. The dialectic proceeds through the multidimension and ties the fragments to each other, unfolding from past to present. The film embodies the multidimensional of the reality it displays and blurs polarities like subject-object, form-content, and life-death that might otherwise fix it within a colonial narrative. At an exemplary moment, Campbell recreates a simple photograph of Stephen Shore in which a cup of coffee stands on a light wooden table as a hand enters in the frame and puts a cup of coffee on the table. The hand enters in again, and this time puts Shore's photograph within the frame, thereby making us see a frame within a frame. We hear the following line. The elements, the material objects of his comings and goings, serve as points of departure for the forming of associations through which the play of concepts become possible. Not only Campbell thus generates a complicated referential connection between the recreated cup and its original image, but also we are led to see how it intends to make possible its disclosure to the viewer in depending on associations. The fourth and final chapter, Reflexes, presents archival footage from the Irish Troubles, an ethno-nationalist conflict that blighted Northern Ireland in the early 1970s. Reflexes is titled subtly, referencing the material's interpretation of a subject. By juxtaposing media representations and his personal commentary, Campbell points at the economic factors behind the manipulative and interest-governed display of events. Campbell's historical context, Northern Ireland, is suggested to be a colonial context, not because it's equivalent to West Africa in all matters, but due to their shared historical factors that yield them as what they are today. This discussion connects to the suggestion that the contemporary British art world, too, is such a context. Through the associations, the suggestion at issue becomes manifest. As an Irish artist, Campbell sees himself to be a colonial subject forced to self-express. The film stands as an art object that is symbolic colonial subject or like an avatar in the British art world, paralleling Campbell. Through the parallels established between Campbell and It for Others, the latter is revealed to transcend its aesthetic features and emerge as a being for itself. Yet, still it can't escape being objectified exactly as it speaks out in its last scene, namely by being valued in terms of a price tag. The film is valued by Turner Prize in 2014, just as it discusses the valuation of objects within contemporary art market being the objectified effect of pricing. Nevertheless, through the dialectical method, the work becomes a model of display. It behaves like an exemplary museum in narrowing the gap between the original and the appropriate context. Ultimately, It for Others doesn't solve the problem straightforwardly. Rather, its solution is to bring the viewer into the awareness of the problem's scope. The viewer is part of the problem because the problem is not just one-sided problem that could be solved in any way of representing, since representing itself is the problem. The film transcends itself and speaks to the viewer, saying that the viewer is, in the present, part of the colonization, knowingly or not. Like a Trojan horse, once It for Others is opened up, it pulls its viewer into the already existent problem. It wakes you up. Thank you.